the best strategy is just start. Okay, so we're just starting here. I haven't been posting recently, last couple days. I have been taping, yes. But I'm giving a little break. It'll ease up a little bit here. I know it's strong. So a little full stop in the wow here. But that doesn't mean I have eased up at all. In fact, I'm coming on stronger than ever, to say the least. So welcome everyone to the video. I don't know if I could say everything, share everything. I share everything with everyone. Okay. I'm a proclaimer. I just proclaim the best I can get. I share with everyone and everyone. Everyone. No exceptions. No specialness here. No specialness. This morning, let me share what happened this morning. Woke up early in the morning, as I often do, and said, okay, what do I do? How do I get going? I just said, why don't I try this? Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. I just started this mantra. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit. I often do this. I just do this. The simple little mantras occur to me. And I just do various different mantras. I do many, many, many different types. Usually it's just calling on the names of the great teachers. And I'll just say their names and combine their names like this. But this time I said, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. And let's just feel good with this. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Kind of calling for help, really. Time is running out on us here. The pressure is upon us. So this opened up a marvelous perspective, then dawned upon me. And so I'm in the wow of that now. So I share this with everyone. Try this. At least put it in the back of your mind. Say, you know, I can do that. I can do that. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. 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 Just call upon this combination. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Wow, what a perspective. Now, I suggest using this as protection, protecting your perspective, protecting this marvelous perspective that dawned upon me. Use it any time during the daytime, any time at all. Just when you feel under pressure, just in your mentally, just say, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. You don't have to be a Christian. I mean, I say... I use mantras that someone would say, you're a Buddhist, obviously you're a Buddhist, or mantras they say, obviously you're a Hindu, right? Or I say, no, I'm just everything and nothing. And what dawned upon me was the recognition. Well, it's many. I mean, when the light dawns upon you, you see the whole world, right? You see everything. So I just saw a total perspective. Wherever I looked, I had this clear perspective on what is it that's troubling us. And we're concurrently everything and nothing. So you can't say what we are, and you can't say what we're not. So we're undefinable. We cannot define God. And of course, what our problem is, we're trying to be greater than God. We're arrogantly trying to define God. And we're insisting that God submit to our definition. And of course, we're trying to soften that demand up. So we have this bifurcation of male-female, we call it energy. But it's really just strategy. It's just male-female strategy. It's just one strategy, one arrogance. But we're trying to forcefully demand that God submit to our definition, and then we're trying to soften up this forceful demand, this demand, so that God accepts it. So the softening up would be the female side of the strategy, and the forceful demand would be the male side of the strategy. It's all just one arrogance. And obviously, what we are, spirit, has nothing, which is God being God, has nothing whatsoever to do with male or femaleness at all. It has nothing to do with the strategy of demanding that God submit to being defined. How can we define pure freedom? God is pure freedom. God, we are simultaneously, concurrently, everything and nothing. How can you encircle that? There's no encirclement. That's also a male-female thing. It's like the female is like the ground, the encirclement, and the male is like the seed, the plant that grows in the ground. So the feminine energy is always strategy. Don't call it energy. It's a strategy. It's always trying to encircle. Whatever you say is trying to encircle it as a definition. And then the male is to say, yeah, this is what I am, this definition. Or a seed, like a seed planted in the ground, grows into a tree, but the tree cannot leave the ground. But what we really are is absolute freedom, which is everything. Simultaneously, I'm everything and nothing, and no thing. Everything and nothing. Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit. What a great perspective. A true dawning of dawning of truth. So hey, we need to get this ecumenicalness, smoothed outness, so we're not trapped by anything at all. Another way to do it, what I saw was everything is equally absurd. Everything is equally absurd. All teachers, all definitions, teacher this, teacher that, this teaching this, it's all equally absurd. There's absolutely nothing to differentiate whatsoever. It's all smoothed out, equal absurdity. It's getting dirty, my cuff's getting dirty again. It's white, there's a problem with white. Yeah, that's okay. I have to clean it. Any definition at all is completely absurd. There's no differentiations to draw. When you hear the people say no mind, I experience no mindness. What it means is that means no definitionness. I stop trying to define what I am, what God is. I stop trying to define what God is, and I experience no mind. But that's just a convention, a way of speaking. What you really experienced is true mind. Free of the attempt to define mind, conceptualize it, define it. It's really defining. So all definitions are equally absurd. I don't care if you say definition is this or that. So the real high teaching is really looks upon all teachings as equally absurd. That's true. You get someone like the Rinzai. Started Rinzai, of Zen Buddhism. It was a Chan Buddhist Rinzai. And he was very iconoclastic. He said, look, all pointers are equally absurd, equally untrue. The Buddha is not true. This is not, none of that is true. There is no Buddha. There is no Buddha mind. None of that is true. Well, this is accurate advice. Look upon all conceptuality as equally untrue. All of it. Including all this non-dual talk, just say it's all equally absurd. Everything is equally absurd. No differentiation. Now, we don't try to recall anything at all. Full stop on the wow. You don't try to recall. There's six points of advice, six points of key advice that Naropa gave out, which was a Mahasiddha in India. Great teacher. Who was a student of Tilopa, who got this directly from Vajrayana, which is the Sambhogakaya of Buddha mind, so to speak, the enjoyment body of Buddha mind. They have these labels, which are all equally absurd, of course. But he got this teaching directly from divinity, we would say. And so he passed it on to Naropa. And the six key points of advice. I just read this a couple days ago, and I said, wow, this is astonishing, because this is exactly what is being taught here in terms of full stop in the wow. Full stop. Now, this is the sovereign advice to give out. And the Holy Spirit just gave this to me. So I didn't get it from Naropa. But of course, Naropa got it from Talopa, who got it from directly from Source, from the grace of God, actually. The Sambhogakaya is really, you might say, it's the Holy Spirit. It's the grace of God. The Nirmanakaya is the appearance of these teachers, great teachers in the world. So that would be God the Son. So they have the Dharmakaya. Buddhism has three bodies: Dharmakaya, Sambhogakaya, and Nirmanakaya. Dharmakaya, it was what we would call God the Father. The Sambhogakaya is what we would call God the Holy Spirit, and the Nirmanakaya is what we would call God the Son. But they're all one. So it's exactly the same. I mean, Buddhism has a trinity. Absolutely has a trinity. Just like Christianity has a trinity. It's the same trinity, actually. Pretty interesting. So we have these teachers here that would be like Jesus, God the Son. That would be called Nirmanakaya in Buddhism. We have this divine grace that orchestrates all our liberation. Christianity would call God the Holy Spirit, and Buddhism would call it the Sambhogakaya, Vajrayana, or they have various terms. So there are teachers who get this directly from Holy Spirit, and that's what I got, this full stop in the wild, directly from the Holy Spirit. And Talopa got this teaching from Sambhogakaya, Vajrayana, aspect of Buddha mind. It's all the same. We're talking about the exact same stuff, actually. Now, I remember India for quite some time. Much of India was Buddhist, and so these are Buddhists. They lived in India. Some of them lived in Bengal area Buddha, like Atisha. I think Naropa might have lived in Bengal too, or Talopa. There's sort of a lot of activity in Bihar and Bengal area of India, which is more the eastern area of India. So these key six points of advice is full stop in the wow. I read it, I said, my God, that's what I was, full stop in the wow. It's exactly it. I was like very, very surprised and shocked. Just, oh my gosh. So I have said we're on the right track, and I repeat that, we're on the right track here. Don't recall, right? Don't imagine the future. Don't recall the past. I say forget. Don't try to remember. How did you get to the full stop in the wild? Don't try to recall how you did it. Don't project in the future what you're going to do with it. What's the future? Oh, I'm going to be a teacher. Teach this. Oh, don't project in the future. Don't fixate on now. Don't try to fixate on now either. It was just really trying to combine the recalling and what doing. Okay, let me fixate then on now. Don't fixate on now. Don't try to figure anything out, which would be strategizing, wouldn't it? Don't strategize. Don't plan. I say don't plan. Don't plan anything. Don't plan. And then don't organize, meaning don't get into an action mode of organizing anything. So don't think about it. Don't try to figure it out. Don't think. Don't organize. Don't plan. No action. This is all full stop in the wow. Just rest, was what Nalopa said. Just rest. But we say just full stop. Not stop in the wow, but full stop in the wow. Stopping in the wow would be try to fixate on now. Fixate. Don't try to fixate. Don't try to fixate. Full stop in the wow. Committed to no action at all. So you're not trying to recall, okay, how did I get here so I can get some action going? You're not trying to imagine what kind of action you're going to do. You're not trying to fixate on now so that can be a plan of action. You're not trying to think about what to do. You're not trying to figure out what to do. You're not trying to organize what to do. You're not trying to analyze. Don't analyze. Don't think. Don't organize. So these are all, this is just this bundle of advice. Full stop on the wild bundle of advice. Naropa just keyed it down to six key precepts. They like doing things in organizing, like in threes and sixes, and you know, this is very, very Buddhist. Here we don't try to enumerate it so much. We just stay away from the enumeration, more or less, because that helps us stop in the wow. We're not trying to say, okay, I'm not trying to fixate on, am I doing, how many points am I doing? No, so we're trying to make it even more abstract. You might say Buddhism overdoes Buddhism. It overdoes Buddhism. Just like you could say Christianity overdoes Christianity. Hinduism overdoes Hinduism, etc. Because they're still caught up in trying to define. Right? This is the continuity fear. The only problem we have is the continuity fear. That's it. The root of our problem, the root is arrogance. In Christianity we call it spiritual pride. The root is arrogance, which is trying to be greater than God, believing that we can find a way to be greater than God, which means we'd have to define God. Because God is everything and nothing. How can you say greater or lesser? There's no greater and there's no lesser in God. It's perfect freedom. So we're trying to define that freedom. That's arrogance. And then from trying to do that, we develop this continuity fear that without definition, we would cease to exist. Because we think, well, if we stop trying to define God, then we will be God. But we're still thinking that God there's some definition. God is definable. So if we give up definition, we think we'll fall into an abyss. We'll think that God is now an abyss. You see this mind freak out that we have? We freaked ourselves out. Freaked our minds out. Now, we cannot entertain drug culture here, okay? This is very important. All right, spirituality tried to accommodate drug culture during the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and it got pulled down. It got pulled down. We here do not accommodate drug use or drug culture. Cannot. This is serious time now. This is go time. Very much go time. So I'd like to pull our consciousness back a little bit prior to the whole drug culture thing, really. Not that culture back then was good, was great. No, it was terrible. But it wasn't as bad as it is now, really. Not at all. No. It was completely, you know, it was easily defined as absurd. And so what happened was drug culture tried to confuse everything, so it made it difficult to see the absurdity. Whereas in the back, like in the early 60s, you could see the absurdity. And people were like transparently absurd. The roles and everything, okay? And so we said, wow, absurdity is getting too obvious. And so the ego tried to confuse it all and brought in the drug culture. So you got to get out of drugs. This is just plain and simple. You know, if you want to really succeed, you have to take some stands. You have to draw a line and just say, okay, there's some things I have to do. It's just plain and simple. That's all there is to it. Do you want to succeed or do you want to fail? It's that cut and dried. If you want to succeed, you have to get out of drugs, plain and simple. And when you work to get out of drugs, you find there's all this stuff pulling you in back into drugs, right? So you got to get out of that too. So just say, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Say, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Now, those are approachable. In Buddhism, they would say, Sambhogakaya, Nirmanakaya. Those are approachable, whereas the Dharmakaya is completely neutral, formless, neutral, nothing you can say about it. It's just the absolute ground of being. It is the pure spaciousness of pure spaciousness. So it seems like there's no way to, for our continuity fear, you know, to relate to it all. So we don't invoke God, the prime creator so much, the Dharmakaya so much. We invoke God the Holy Spirit, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, God the Son, God, and then that leads us back to realizing that we are God. See, there's no enlightenment. There's no one getting enlightened. There's God being God. You can just be. There's not someone being enlightened. There's enlightenment being enlightened. There's nobody being enlightened. That's why I say all these teachers, to say it's all equally absurd. There are no teachers, which is true. There are no teachers. Everything is equally absurd. Everything is equally absurd. Okay, it's all completely absurd. There's only enlightenment being enlightenment. There's only God being God. There's no one being enlightened. There's no person. There's no concept being enlightened. Now, the Holy Spirit has suggested a theme song. Seriously, I mean, this is pretty amazing. I had the most amazing experience with this. I said, really? The Holy Spirit says, yes. Wow, what's going on? Okay. Sidewalk Surfing by Jan and Dean. Released in, was it 64, maybe? Could have been late 63, maybe 1964. This was still prior to drug culture, okay? 63, 64, it was, that time. Beach Boys released this song called Catch a Wave on the album called Surfer Girl, I believe, in 1963. The surf culture thing really started in 58, 59, with Jan and Dean, actually. They were before the Beach Boys. Jan Berry and Dean Torrance, down in SoCal, Southern California. Jan and Dean start developing this sound with sort of falsetto and a doo-wop, sort of doo-wop with a high falsetto sound and multi-layered vocals and all that. They actually started that before Brian Wilson and the Beach Boys. But then Brian Wilson wrote this song called Catch a Wave. And what we're doing is that we're cooling down from the wild a little bit. See, I interweave this stuff. It's important to just be casual with this. It helps full stop in the wild. Don't fixate. Don't fixate on the truth. Don't fixate on now. Don't fixate on now. Rest in it. Don't fixate in it. I wonder if it was Tilopa that gave the six key advice. The Naropa did the Mahamudra by the Ganges. Maybe it was Tilopa. I think it was Tilopa. Sorry. It was Tilopa with the six keys of advice. Tilopa was very, very profound. And then Naropa gave the Mahamudra, of Ganges, of the Ganges Mahamudra, which is also very profound. I'll read that to you sometime. Extraordinarily great advice. Okay. So, Brian Wilson wrote Catch a Wave. Catch a wave and you're sitting on top of the world. Don't be afraid to try the greatest. Greatest sport around. The greatest sport around. Don't be afraid to try the greatest sport around. Those who don't, try to put it down. You paddle out, turn around and raise. And baby, that's all there is to the coastline craze. You gotta catch a wave and you're sitting on top of the world. Now, so this song, now Jan and Dean went to Brian Wilson, and they had this thing about skateboarding, and they said, you know, surfers are making these skateboards at home, so when they're not surfing, they can practice the moves and the balance of surfing. So they're putting these skates, roller skate wheels from skates onto these boards called skateboarding. So this people just made these in garages. I mean, I made my own skateboard back then. That's what we were doing. We attached them, took off skates from wheels from skates, and then cut these boards out and screwed them on, bolted them on to these boards. I made my skateboards. I did. And my friends, is what we did. We did this. We were like original skateboarders and surfers. But I was into surfing and skateboarding when I was young, 7, 8 years old, that kind of thing. So he wanted to make this song, and he went to Brian Wilson. He wanted to make a song about skateboarding. So Brian Wilson and Roger Christian, who helped him write some songs early on, before Van Dyke Parks came along and helped him out. He was a lyrical collaborator. They wrote the lyrics to Sidewalk Surfing. And then Brian Wilson said, why don't you just use our song Catch a Wave, use that, the music of that, for this song. So I think Brian Wilson wrote about 10 songs for Jan and Dean, actually. He wrote Surf City, which was a number one hit, and just gave it to him. He never got any royalties for that at all. He didn't care. It's amazing, you know, the collaboration of what went on there. Wonderful collaboration. Surf City was a number one hit for Jan and Dean. Really made them very popular. Jan and Dean were really big time back in the early 60s, the mid 60s. They hosted the Tammy Show, TAMI show, which was a precursor to music videos. It was really kicked off with everything that came after that. It was amazing how influential it was. And then Jan had an accident, a car accident. He at first had an accident on a movie set, and then had a car accident and had brain damage from it. They wrote the song Dead Man's Curve, and then 2 years later he had an accident right by Dead Man's Curve. It just, you know, a Corvette hit a parked truck. And so that knocked him out of commission for a year, and then they're never the same. But before that, they were very, very powerful and big stuff. Jan Berry was one of the key record producers on the West Coast, like Lee Hazelwood, Phil Spector, and Brian Wilson. Those were the big guns. When you had Lou Adler and Herb Alpert, you know, were also some of the big guns there. I think they had something to do with Mamas and Papas. I mean, this was a very intense music scene and cultural scene. But it was before the drug scene hit, okay? The freakout scene, the drug scene. Said, oh, things are becoming too transparent. We better, confuse it all. Because it was. It was very superficial and transparent. But this actually was a door into recognition. And the drug culture screwed it all up. So, Sidewalk Surfing. There's a video on YouTube that I've been watching. It's really extraordinary. It's like huge wow. It's just a Jan and Dean video, music video of that. And they're surfing, they're skating down this road down to a beach. It might be Malibu Beach or something. It's one of those areas there, near Santa Monica probably. But anyway, it's they're going down the grade, and they're surfing down to the beach, and they go down to the beach, and then they run onto the beach. And then they go running into the water. The ocean, the sea. And then Jan falls down and gets completely immersed in the ocean whereas Dean does not. Dean's the blonde-haired one. Jan's more the darker-haired one. Jan was the genius behind it. He was a genius. He was actually the son of an aeronautical engineer who worked with Howard Hughes. Close associate of Howard Hughes, built the Spruce Goose and was on the maiden flight and only flight of the Spruce Goose with Howard Hughes. And then Dean was, his dad was, went to Stanford University. He was some really intelligent. These people came from extremely intelligent families. And Jan was a genius, really brilliant genius. So he goes running into the ocean and immerses himself. And Dean does not go in the ocean. And so Jan starts splashing Dean. Come on, get wet, get wet, get wet. The thing is very, very symbolic spiritually. And the Holy Spirit has me watching this. Watch this. And then I caught something, which is really extraordinary. So they didn't come out, staggering out of the ocean. Staggering out like they've just been through this amazing, intense experience. And then Jan unbuttons, he has a Letterman sweater with three stripes on it, which is very interesting too. I'll get into that. Now you may say, what does this have to do with anything? What has to do with everything and nothing? And so we remain in this casual mode, and yet, but you know I'm going to say something that is just a mind blower. So, but it's casual. It's all fine. It's all good. He opens up his, unbuttons his Letterman sweater, and he opens it up, and he's showing everybody the camera. And what does it have? He has this athletic shirt on. It says number 22. It says 22 on it. He's making it very clear. You've got to pay attention to 22. Well, if you look up 22 as an esoteric number, it is the divine manifestation, the divine manifesting here on earth, which is the Nirmanakaya. And then after that, Dean collapses on the beach, I believe face down. Face up, I'm not sure. But he collapses like he's dead, and he lies on the beach like he's dead. And then Jan collapses too, but he's on his elbows there, and he's not quite dead. And he's just looking like, wow, I'm just really almost dead, but not quite dead. I'm still alive, whereas Dean was dead. And I'm watching this, I'm just getting, you know, just almost, I'm just saying, wait a minute, what's going on here? What's really going on here? Now, if you really look in the number 22, it's the number of Jesus' return, actually. 11 was his first coming, 22 is his second coming. 2-2, also second coming, yeah. It's the divine manifesting here in the world to enlighten us and to do something to help us. Sidewalk surfing. Grab your board and go sidewalk surfing. Don't be afraid to try the newest sport around. Don't be afraid to try the newest sport around. You say nudist sport? Well, naked awareness means pure, non-conceptual awareness. Okay, newest sport around, non-duality actually. It's catching on in every city and town. You can do the tricks the surfers do. Just try the Quasimodo or the coffin too. Why don't you grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me? Now the coffin or the Quasimodo these are some tricks the longboard riders did. Is they lie down on their board like they're dead, or they get into some Quasimodo hunchback sort of thing, whatever. But it can be referring to the world's all equally absurd. It's all equally dead. All belief and definition is equally dead. Okay, it's very, very symbolic. You'll probably wipe out, the next verse goes, you'll probably wipe out when you first try to shoot the curve. Okay. Now, this is very interesting too. is this curve, is this millennial curve that we've gone through, this huge change. We're trying to go in going around this millennium, the year 2000, as we go around this and into this great new world order situation. Not great, well, it's awful, but it's a huge, intense pressure. You're probably going to wipe out. Now, in skateboarding, it means when you're going down a sidewalk and there's a grade and you stay on the sidewalk, you go around a curve when you go into another street, there's a curve on the sidewalk, you probably got to make that quick turn. You're probably going to fall off your board, is what they're saying. They're probably going to fall off your board. So he's saying as we go towards this very intense time that was coming, you're probably going to wipe out. Probably going to wipe out. And the next line goes, taking gas in a bush takes a lot of nerve. Well, taking gas means you're falling into a bush, and as you go around a turn, you fall off your board and you fall into a bush. And taking gas is a way of saying also taking drugs. And what do drugs do? They kind of ruin your nerve, don't they? Takes away your nerve. Taking drugs takes away your nerve. So when you wipe out, he says, you'll probably wipe out when you first try to shoot the curve. So when you're trying to get free of this new world order that's coming and get into non-duality, you're probably going to have troubles. And you're probably going to get into drugs, drug culture, sex, drugs, rock and roll. You're going to wipe out in this bush, and it's going to take away your nerve. Okay, very, very prophetic stuff. 1 minute here, some people are coming here.
Hi.
We're out of the Hammers.
Yeah.
Yes. We accidentally threw a basketball over there. Absolutely.
Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Nice
thank
shot, you. Huh? Have a good day there? Good workout?
It's in the rain, right?
Yeah.
That's cool.
By the way.
Nice to meet you.
Bye, Ross.
Okay.
Okay, that was very interesting. Very, very, very interesting. Three young guys. Like my age when I back in like side when I was skateboarding, started 60, 7 or 8 years old, came over. They lost a basketball here. So, and what are their names? Jude and Luke. Two Lukes, I believe. And Jude, Saint Jude. I've been praying to Saint Jude lately. I found a card on the ground, Saint Jude. So, pretty amazing stuff. They lost their bother, the wipe out when you first try to shoot the curve, right? Okay, so this is really extraordinary. Very nice young boys. Very, 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 very nice. The feel they have is back with a feel like we had in 1963. They have that feel actually to them. They're not so corrupted actually. Drug culture hasn't corrupted them yet. Gangster culture, all the stuff that's designed to confuse. Taking gas in a bush takes a lot of nerve. And then it goes on, the song goes on. The hopscotch hodads and pedestrians too will bug you. Shout cowabunga. I like a cowabunga. Cuyabunga turned into Cowabunga, but actually it says shout Cuyabunga now and skate right on through. So it goes, the hopscotch hoededs and pedestrians too will bug you. Shout Cuyabunga now and skate right on through. See, the hopscotch hoededs and pedestrians too will bug you. Shout Cuyabunga now and skate right on through. Why don't you grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me? Now, the hopscotch hoedads, back then they played hopscotch on the sidewalks. We used to play hopscotch in the sidewalks. Hop on one leg, pick up the what you threw on the ground, the little roll. So there were a lot of people playing hopscotch on the sidewalks back then. Kids. And then pedestrians walking on the sidewalk. So what they're saying is they'll bug you when you're skating on the sidewalk. They'll say, hey, you know, don't skate on through. Wait a second, I'm coming back here. So he was worried about, let me see. I was worried about if the basketball sound is causing problems. I said, no, it doesn't pick it up. It doesn't pick it up at all, which it really, it's just very, very minimal here. But, because they didn't want to cause problems with the recording or something. I said, no, it doesn't pick up at all. No, don't be concerned at all. He said, I'm sorry to bother you. Very, very nice, polite, intelligent, young people, huh? So the hopscotch hoedads and pedestrians too will bug you, shout Cuyabunga, and skate right on through. So what they're saying is, you know, the people of the world will bug you, okay? But bug, you're trying to skate right on through. But they say, just, you know, shout Cuyabunga me, hey, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Just skate right on through it. Don't let it bother you. So this culture will bug you, okay? But don't just have this shout, this mantra, you know, this focus. Here I come, you know, and just skate right on through it. That's what he's saying. Now, sidewalk surfing, the term sidewalk, what's a sidewalk? It's on the side of the road. Okay, well, I've been talking about sidestepping the problems of the world. Sidestep 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 the problems of the world. Sidewalk surfing. Stay on the sidewalk. Don't. Now, it's not surfing the big waves of the ocean, where the big waves of the ocean are crushed the heck out of you. Okay. The ocean is relentless. It'll brutalize you. Actually. But so sidewalk surfing is a reduced intensity activity. So what it's really saying, grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me. It says grab your vehicle, as it were, your body, mind, grab your what you are, and go to reduced intensity zone. That's really what it's getting at. So, you know, anybody can sidewalk surf. Just little kids can do it, right? And but you think you can do what the surfers do, kind of like. So it's a way. It's a reduced intensity activity, actually. So you're not going out into the ocean and dealing with all the difficulties of that, which are very dangerous, actually, very scary. Now, sidewalk surfing has some spills and too and stuff, but it's nothing compared to getting out there in the ocean, especially a cold ocean like Northern California. This is not a joke. And the world is no joke. It's like a vast cold ocean of Buddhism would say samsara, which is delusion, arrogance, absurdity, actually. It's a vast, vicious ocean of absurdity. Stay out of that ocean. Grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me. Okay, reduce the intensity. It's okay. Now, it says, then it says, so get your girl and take her a tandem down the street. In other words, this is an act. So get your girl and take her tandem down the street. Then she'll think that you're an asphalt athlete. Okay, so it's saying like, it's okay to set culture in this reduced intensityness. Okay, and she'll think, oh, you're an asphalt athlete. How wonderful! No, you don't have to be this hero. Okay. You don't have to be this hero riding the big waves of the ocean. So it's saying, hey, let's set our sights on a reduced intensity zone here. And they're saying, you know, for the feminine, the male, and the female, the masculine, the feminine, let's both agree to this. And so the women would say, hey, it's okay. You're an asphalt athlete. You're not some big hero. But I don't need a hero. I don't need a hero. We don't need heroes trying to get God, trying to insist upon a definition of God. We don't need that. So let's lower our sights on it. So reduce it. Say, oh, here's my wonderful, yeah, he's not some football player, you know, some line quarterback. No, he's an asphalt athlete. He's sidewalk surfing. It's simpler, isn't it? It's a great simplification. So get your girl and take her tandem down the street. Then she'll think that you're an asphalt athlete. A downhill grade man will give you a kick. Okay, so a downhill grade, a hill, man, that'll give you a kick. In other words, it gives you a thrill because you start going fast. And you've got to turn, and try to slow it down. It's not easy. We used to go down some hills that were way too steep. It was crazy stuff. I never could do it. I never was able to master the art of skateboarding. I didn't have the nerve quite. I tried a lot. I tried, but it you have to be a little reckless, actually. And I'm not. I tend to not be reckless. I tend to be more conservative and cautious, which is a good thing, actually. This is what you want. In a time like this, you want someone who's not reckless. So a downhill grade man will give you a kick, but if the sidewalks crack, now you better pull out quick. Okay? This is the kicker to the song. Now on the song, the lyrics supposed to say, if the sidewalks cracked, you better pull out quick. But it sounds very much like, if the sidewalks crack, you better pull out quick. Plural. It sounds, when I listen to this song, it sounds very pluralistic. It's not like if the sidewalks cracked, I mean this sidewalk you're on. It more sounds like if the sidewalks, plural instead of possessive, if the sidewalks crack, instead of cracked, ED, if the sidewalks crack, you better pull out quick. Meaning if this world starts going crazy, you better get out of here quick. You better get out of here. So this non-dual effort is reduced intensity, is to simplify. You become more and more simplified in your approach. You see, everything is equally absurd. All thingness, all belief is equally absurd. All beliefs equally absurd. It's all equally absurd. This is a very important rest in the full stop in the wow of that. But if this world starts to crack up, you better pull out quick. Why don't you grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me? Come skating. Come. skateboard with me? Why don't you skateboard with me? Grab your board and go sidewalks or everything. Skateboard with me? Why don't you skateboard with me? Da, da, da. And then it ends up like that. You know, beautiful Brian Wilson, Jan and Dean collaboration song. It's just, it's still awesome. It holds up now just unbelievably well. And the Holy Spirit also brought up to me the Drag City, that it goes wine, wine, wine. Burn up that quarter mile. That holds up too. It's burn out, burn out, burn up that quarter mile. Burn up that quarter mile. I mean, we're in the quarter mile now, the last phase. Burn it up, meaning just go fast, go all out in that last quarter mile. These musicians like that, Brian Wilson was a genius too. They usually, oftentimes, they're very prophetic, and they code it into music, and it's done superficially. They're just like normal people, and just all problems and everything. But there's an inner genius. Their subconscious, so to speak, it is playing through the subconscious. Plays through, not their subconscious, the subconscious is playing through them into the music and coding various things. And if you're, of course, the Beatles, people thought they were coding everything, but that was a different play, actually. It was more of a drug culture thing. The Beatles helped bring in drug culture, to tell the truth about it. I was always a Beach Boy fan, Jan and Dean Beach Boy fan, not a Beatles fan, actually. I mean, the Beatles were hooked in with Tavistock Institute and the whole Illuminati New World Order thing, actually. Absolutely, they were. At least the entity, we say, the Beatles. Now, George Harrison tried to, you know, get away from that, actually, and say, hey, look, I'd rather do this. But that initial entity, you know, that was they were very much manufactured by the Illuminati New World Order, the Beatles. So they helped bring in the drug culture. But the Beach Boys, Jan and Dean, very different. Very different. Now what happened with Brian Wilson is he saw his what he was doing being submerged by the British invasion. 64, right, I believe. Started 64, 65, British invasion. And so he tried to compete with them, and he started taking drugs. This is the problem, what happened with him. And he just absolutely wiped him out. Took gas in a bush. He really did. Badly, terribly, one of the worst examples. One of the worst examples there was. It was terrible. He ended up being a vegetable, just lying in bed for like 2 or 3 years, turning into a blimp. I mean, he just took every drug as much as possible, you know, LSD, cocaine, marijuana, whatever there was. He was just, because this music, the British invasion, was heavily, heavily bringing in the drug culture. And it took over the music industry, and so Brian Wilson was trying to bring it, to get it back, to win it back. So he was trying to create some music that was just so awesome that it would bring people back out of that. So he was willing to go into drugs to try and see, is there something there? What are people, why are people so interested in this? So what can I do to bring them back? So what he did was, what he did was very heroic, actually, Brian Wilson. excessively, unfortunately, heroic. And I understand that, because I had the same problem, very similar problem. But I wasn't as reckless as he was. He felt he could do it, and I did too. So I did a tremendous amount of effort to see if we can bring music out of that, but didn't work. But I was able to, well, I'm here now, being able to do this. So obviously something right happened, something good path, was on a good path. Whereas Brian Wilson is still, not quite back, really. So he tried to do something very heroic and said, no, let's keep the music in this direction. And, you know, terrible. I went down with the ship too, and when that went down, I went down with it too. And we were just like devastated by the drug culture music. Actually, it was terrible. Just listen to like the Beach Boys, like Good Timin', the song Good Timin', or I can hear music. Songs like that, Good Timin', I Can Hear Music. I mean, that sound, just listen to the sound. The sounds of the city, baby, seem to disappear. You know? Now, they put it into romantic context, so people will listen to it, but it's really not about romance at all. And good timing is just, it takes good timing. You need good timing. Good timing, yeah. They're very spiritual. Now, Mike Love is the front man that helped sell it all. He was sort of the playboy front man to it. That was the role he's played. And so he kind of sold his sun and surf and this cultural thing. But the music actually was designed to keep us out of the drug culture. So we would avoid that. And ultimately it helped pull me out of that whole culture. We're talking about a culture here, okay? Whether you use drugs or not, it's the culture that you're immersed in. We were immersed in a drug culture, and still are, worse than ever, actually. But back then it was raw. Now it's more sophisticated. Okay, now it's more so. Back then you could see it better. Now it's more disguised. Now it's more disguised. Okay, it's everywhere. It's all pervasive. It's all acceptable now. And back then, you know, it's like shocking. It was shocking. Like, wow. And Brian Wilson said, look, he went on Mike Douglas' show, he said, look, this stuff's terrible, stay away from it. He said, I'm a perfect example of why you want to stay away from it. You can look on YouTube, Brian Wilson, Mike Douglas' show. He says, I took all this stuff, and I took constant, every day, I took so much of it, and it just wiped me out. It ruined my mind, it destroyed me. It was horrible. Don't, anybody listening to this, don't do it, stay away from it. Yeah, yeah. Exactly what he said. So Brian Wilson, to many, is a hero. He was a hero, but you know, you've got to be wiser than that. Fortunately, I got great spiritual help, because I was willing to put in the work, and was willing to not do the music, you know, and say there's something more important. We had that. But I was tempted. I was pulled into music again by Brian Wilson. Remember the song "I Get Around" by the Beach Boys. He's got like one of the most ultimate hooks there's ever been into a song, and I realized, wow, this music is just amazing. And so I said, I want to do something like this too, this type of music. But that was a mistake, because I came here not to do music again, but to do spiritual, sing the song of spiritual truth, liberation from absurdity and arrogance, really. So I was willing to put in the work to do that. So instead of putting all the work in music, I put it into spiritual study and contemplation. So I didn't become a rock star, a music star again. I became, you know, this, just an advocate, a friend of everyone, just a friend advocating, you know, that yes, we can be liberated from delusion and be God being God. We are God, but we're God being God, God the Son. There's God the Prime Creator. How can we be God being God unless there's first God, right? So there's God, and then there's God being God, you know, in terms of, but you could also say it's all simultaneous and concurrent too. However, you can't flip that and say there's not a root, not a Prime Creator. So the Holy Spirit advocated going back in time. And I went out and bought some shoes yesterday. Holy Spirit said, go to the shoe store. I went there. It was super crowded. It's unbelievable. Everybody was buying shoes. And I said, what is going on here? Parking lot was jammed. The store was jammed. The line was like 30 feet long or more. Okay, so I went to the bargain bin, and I found this pair of white sneakers. Kind of old style sneakers, like you'd wear back in the 60s. As I dressed like Jan and Dean. I had white Levi's and a red and white striped shirt, and a blue and white too. Those were my favorite shirts back then. I just loved it. And white tennis shoes. And so I got these white tennis shoes. I'm wearing all white now, basically. White Levi's or white jeans, which I used to wear back then, and a white shirt. Just all white shirt, very nice shirt, and white jacket with just this red stripe on it. White is a very important color. It's a symbol of simplicity of mind, to simplify your mind. And I went to a white background here, as you can see. Simplicity of mind is reduced intensity of conceptuality and absurdity, okay? This is very important here. So, let me say this. In order to be liberated from absurdity, you have to be a genius from some angle, okay? But the good news is everyone is a genius. Genius is native to us. So, I also have a white watch. You can't see it because it's all white, right? But you can see the face is black, but the band is white. Everything's white. We're going back to focusing on simplicity. It's super important to realize it's okay to be simple. And, you know, the women, this dance of strategy, male, female, it's just a strategy to demand definition from God, to get God to submit to definition. It's just strategy, okay? There isn't any separate man, separate woman thing kind of thing. That's all nonsense. It's just strategy is all it is. So that aspect of the strategy we call female has to stop demanding, manipulating that part of the strategy called male. Stop demanding they be heroes. Reduce the intensity of that demand. It's very important. Accept men becoming simpler. Just sitting here, you know, not playing the role of a hero. That's very helpful. Reducing that part of the strategy, the female part of the strategy. And the males have to accept not trying to be heroes. Do less. It's like, so I went out on the golf course when it was storming real bad. Just a couple days ago, and I did a video about that. A couple of them, I didn't post it I might at some point, but the gist of it was practice for me to simplify, to be under duress from all angles, which it was. It was on a scale of 1 to 10 of difficulty, it was a 12. There was no easiness there whatsoever, zero. I was under duress from all angles. It was in the middle of a tempest, and everything was super saturated with water. There are no dry lies, nothing was dry. There were rivers running down fairways, lakes on the fairways everywhere. You hit a great shot and it ends up in a lake on the fairway, the ball's lost. It was blowing, so we kept inverting, my umbrella was blowing so hard. It was cold, it was the rain was pounding, thunderstorms pounding down. And I was playing 18 holes of golf on a monster golf course with the worst rough you've ever seen in your life. And I said, I'm playing today, and the people there said, you're crazy. I said, yeah, I know. So I put myself under duress intentionally, which is what I've done in this world. I intentionally put myself under duress that you're experiencing, so I would know how to counsel and how to help. So I put myself through all sorts of duress, but intentionally. I did it intentionally. Of course, we do everything intentionally, but I was conscious of it. I'm saying, okay, how would it be to go into this duress and see what it's like? So I know what it's like. I know what it's like to be under duress from all angles. And what do? The old habits don't work. The old habits don't work anymore at all. It's amazing. And I struggled so badly, I almost had a meltdown on the eighth hole. I said, oh my gosh, this is just unbelievable. Even when I do something right, it turns out wrong. And you just have to accept that you're gonna take some hits there. I mean, you're going to, even the good stuff backfires, you know, wow. Okay, play very, very, and you tend to narrow your focus, get tunnel vision, you don't see the big picture, all this stuff happens. So I'm aware of what happens. And I can tell you this for sure, I know the way to help out, and it's simplicity, 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 simplicity. Lower your expectations, lower your expectations. A reduced intensity zone is available. We can do this. We don't have to be these mahasiddhas like right now, you know. No, don't have to. Don't try to do too much. So I didn't use my driver. I used it one time, where there was a lake on 17, I had to get over, it was not supposed to be there, just because it's on the fairway, and I couldn't clear it with my forewood. So I said, wow, I better hit driver. And it sliced a little bit and got lost somewhere in the rough or in the bushes. I don't know, I couldn't find it. But other than that, I never hit my driver, you see? And I shouldn't have hit it on that hole. I'm not sure. Well, I got to hit my driver better is the answer. I went home and practiced, and I said, okay, now I know I'm not going to, I have to hit it at least once. I'll hit it, I'll be able to hit it right next time. But so reduce your goal, so to speak. Ultimate liberation, don't go for that ultimate liberation. Go to work on simplification right now. Work on simplification. This is what I'm saying. Now, I've experienced the ultimate goal. I say, okay, it's there. I say, fine. It's easy, actually. It's easy. You just have to let go of absurdity. Be willing to let go of absurdity entirely. And see, all absurdity is just one. Everything. Including all the great teachers and teachings that have been in this world, that's also completely absurd. All of it's completely absurd, which is what the sudden school of like Chan Buddhism is. That's what they emphasize, actually. They used to emphasize that. They probably still do some ways, but what they're getting at is no matter what you say about it, no matter how you conceptualize it, it's not it at all. It's not it at all. And so it's absurd. Don't try to say, well, it's almost it. No, it's not. What we are is everything and nothing simultaneously, and that's all that we are. There's no other way to put it, but saying that too is absurd, because it's not the experiencing of it. Jesus' great book, Journey Beyond Words, transcribed by Dr. Brent Haskell. Thank you very much, Dr. Brent Haskell. is the title Journey Beyond Words. He says you have to go beyond all ideas and concepts of truth and experience it. Otherwise, you're just you're spinning your wheels. But how do you do that, you see? How do you accept that? And you have to simplify. You have to simplify. And don't get fixated. Don't get fixated even on the great teachers. So you see me bouncing around here and talking about this teacher, that teacher. But I don't get fixated on it. I don't get fixated on any one particular teacher or teaching. But it's very important. Don't get fixated. Don't even get fixated in the now. Don't fixate on the now. Because that's still conceptual. You must abide in the now, or rest in the now. You know, there's various terms, but even that isn't it. Even that is absurd. You must be the now, but you're God being God, actually. And you're nothing else other than that. Nothing is. Everything is God being God right now. So I have experienced that. I can say that. If I had the holy instant, I experienced this. And I said, that's interesting. Wow. Wow. Yeah. So I'm confident of what I'm speaking of, about simplify. Stop looking for the great teachers. You know, I need to find this. Simplify your approach. Simplify your approach. Lower your expectations. Go sidewalk surfing with me, so to speak. Why don't you grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me? Go skateboard with me. Why don't you skateboard with me? Why don't you skateboard with me? Why don't you skateboard with me? That's the end of the refrain. Skateboard with me. Come on, skateboard with me. Why don't you skateboard? Yeah, why don't you go sidewalk surfing with me? Go back to that simplified look in your life. Now, maybe you weren't there, so we reintroduced a simplified look. Now, this is catching on subconsciously, okay, in the world. If you look at cars, what do you see? The cars are colored white. White. This is the new color. White is the new color in cars. So people subconsciously are realizing we need to simplify our approach. Severely simplify our approach. Wow. Just full stop on the wow. That's the only practice you need, actually. Just reduce it all to one practice. This encompasses all practices. This is at the heart of all practices in history, really. Just full stop in the wow. Tilopa enumerated very nicely. And we're clarifying it, presenting it very nicely. Full stop in the wow. It's the great technique, because you must simplify. Don't worry, you don't have some great master here teaching. The Holy Spirit is the master of all masters, and everyone has that within them. Where did Tilopa get the teaching? From the Holy Spirit. From the Sambhogakaya, from the mind, the Sambhogakaya mind of the Buddha mind, which refers to just God. We'll call it God. It's the same thing. We're talking about exactly the same thing. Buddha mind. Samantabhadra, what do you want to call it, is God. In Christianity, we call it God. God the Father. But God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, actually. It's Trinity. Hinduism, Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. Trinity. Trinity. Very obvious. Very blatantly obvious, right? Simplify, simplify, simplify. So, white, wearing white, and no patterns on it, hardly any patterns. I use a little lining like black or red or something to signify that you're still in the world. Okay, so we're not rejecting the world per se, and we're not into asceticism. Of course, Buddha, middle path, means simplify everything also. You don't go into all these extremes of asceticism with all those practices. You don't go into all the extremes of trance states. which are tantric, a lot of tantric practice, trance states. You don't do either. Those middle path is actually the way to true liberation. You listen to these great teachers. I mean, you wonder. Buddhists need to listen to Buddha more, and Christians need to listen to Jesus more, so to speak. Meaning, are we really doing what they said? Are we really following their advice, actually? Are we really following their advice? Buddha said middle path. Keep it simple is what he's saying. Keep it very simple. Simplify your approach. Do not go into all these extremes. These extremes breed more extremes. This world puts you under this insane duress. Jesus said, there's nowhere for the Son of God to rest here, to lay his head. Nowhere. And out in the golf course, Holy Spirit put me out there. It tricked me into it. Holy Spirit said, go play golf. I said, wow, it's stormy, it's rainy. Holy Spirit said, check the AccuWeather forecast. So I looked online and said, oh my gosh, it says supposed to be sunny from 2 to 5:30. I can get in. I can play golf. Wonderful. And it felt, and the sun just came out there and it felt very balmy and nice. I said, oh, great. I'm going to sneak it in here. I got down there. It was like just terrible, storming. There was no break in the weather whatsoever. Getting AccuWeather forecast wrong again. I said, Holy Spirit, you said it would be nice. And the Holy Spirit said, well, you know, could you forgive me? And I said, oh yeah, I understand what this is for. Thank you very much. If you'd have told me it would be stormy, I wouldn't have gone. So the Holy Spirit does this little play, okay? Little white lies, so to speak, from the Holy Spirit. It is to say, it looks like it might be clear, you know. It's not. It gets past our reluctance. I say, oh, it's okay. That's great. Thank you very much. I say, it's the best round of golf I ever had in my life. Because it was the most intense, to say the least. And I did pretty well. Did a lot of things very well. Including almost having a meltdown, knowing what that's like. So I know what almost having a meltdown is like under the intensity that's about to come in this world, where we will be under duress from every angle, actually. We will be under duress from every angle. No place to lay our head, nowhere to take refuge. Nowhere here. Except in your own discipline, in your own simplification, in your own don't play the hero. Don't play the hero. Don't play the hero. So this whole thing about playing a hero, that is a male-female strategizing, okay? Let's stop bifurcating this male-female thing as if one side has the answer and the other doesn't, or one side's good and the other's bad. That is utter nonsense. It's all one arrogance using this bifurcated strategy to try to trick God, try to get God to accept some definition of God instead of God being God is both everything and nothing, both everywhere and nowhere, both, simultaneously both, intrinsically both, and neither, right? Both and neither, you can't define God, you cannot define God. So we play these practices of both and neither, neither this nor that, both this and both that, neither this nor that. This is helps us simplify, conceptually simplify, it's very helpful. So the ultimate practice is full stop in the wow, and there's some techniques to help us with that, which is ultimately simplifying our approach, okay? It's simplifying our approach. This is what enables us to withstand the horrible duress that is to come upon the world very soon, within a matter of months, 90 days or something, you know, so it will start. And you'll feel it July 24th, you're going to feel it. Okay, there's going to be a shift on July 24th of this year. You want to have already have simplified your approach and be committed to that. So this is the year of commitment. Commit to simplifying your approach. Whether you're male strategy, whether you're emphasizing male strategy or emphasizing female strategy, simplify your approach. Commit to simplifying your approach. This is all you need to do as far as your stance goes in this world. Okay, as far as your creed or whatever, you say, I'm simplifying my approach. I'm committed to that. I'm committed to simplifying the approach. Of course, as we simplify the approach, it becomes more and more apparent to us that maybe God cannot be defined and is not being tricked by what we're doing. But that's good. But then there's a wow. That's a wow. Like, wow. Maybe everything's okay. Maybe there isn't an abyss. Wow. Maybe I can go back home. Wow. You see, so managing our success in the path is our discipline. Okay? Practice full stop on the wow. Techniques, there's several techniques. I already have is one of the basic ones, and neither nor a couple of techniques. Practice is full stop in the wow. The discipline is managing our success on the spiritual path, and our creed, our commit is commit to simplification. Commit to reducing it down to simplifying. Commitment to simplification here. That's it. No matter whether you're, whatever your background, whatever your religion, whatever your strategy has been, it's all the same here. See, we're completely ecumenical in that regard. And no matter what your gender, age, or anything, it's commitment to simplification. Commitment to simplification. Now, yesterday the Holy Spirit showed me that something dawned also upon me that was really, I didn't tape it about it, no. It showed me how bad things are going to get. Wow. I was in the shoe store. That's when I realized it. And I saw these men and these women, male strategy, female strategy, and I saw what's happening. What are they preparing for? I said, wow, God. What are these people preparing for? And they're preparing to self-medicate. They're preparing strategies to try and cope with what's coming. Let me tell you this right off the bat. There is going to be massive, unprecedented, completely off-the-charts prostitution in the world. Okay. Tremendous amount of female strategy is wrapped around prostitution, which is the oldest profession in the world, really. And this has been used throughout history. When things get bad, a lot of women resort to that because it's a way to keep their power, get money, and keep buying the things they want, keep feeding desire, absurdist desire for complexity and trickiness, keep it going. But also you find out that the new power structure that comes into being when something collapses and is destroyed, oftentimes it's the cleverest prostitutes that end up getting the highest position of power in that new regime because they become concubines of the generals, the warriors, the ones that conquerors. They end up becoming concubines. And then they work their way up the ladder of the concubines to being the top concubine, the mistress, top mistress. And then they end up being the power of the throne controlling the male strategy. And that just happens over and over and over again throughout history, actually. And like the conquerors, like conquering armies come in and destroy the town, kill all the men, and what happens to the women? Well, the attractive ones, the ones that can have the strategy, they end up being camp followers, it's called, and they follow this conquering army, being prostitutes to the soldiers. But and they get food, they get money, and then ultimately they get position. And then they try to work their way up the power structure, which they're able to do. They're able to do. So this has been going on throughout history. So it's the same old play is happening right now. And women are preparing, many are preparing like crazy. I've been very aware of this for a long time. To be the best prostitutes they can possibly be. To latch on to the male power structure. Whatever men have the power. And of course, they're breaking down morality. The whole culture is so that it's perfectly acceptable for these powerful males to have as many mistresses as they like, as many concubines as they like. But it's breaking down in more ways than that actually. People will be self-medicating, female with female, male with male too. It goes in all directions because everybody will be so desperate to self-medicate. They don't have the technique, spiritual wisdom to practice this full stop on the wow. So they will they will medicate with sex. Just unbelievable amount of sex will be taking place in this world. Prostitution, getting money from it as much as possible. Women are very skilled at this, actually. And some are also, some men tends to go in the gay culture. They also, a lot of gay prostitutes, and that culture too is skillful at how to make money out of sex. And so you will have all these issues going on, and then of course that doesn't work, because the confusion that's coming, the meltdown of duress, is something, it causes a mental meltdown, and people will be going crazy. They'll go literally going insane, going postal, going ballistic. This is what will happen in this world, because the old habits don't work anymore. Nothing seems to work. Even the good stuff won't work. I experienced this. I finally figured I hit a great shot and went into a bunker, lost ball. It was a lake. I said, holy cow, I didn't expect such a good result. So even the good results that we get end up being negative. And this is what causes a meltdown. It's just, we can't win. We can't win. The old ways of heroism are being broken down. I'm trying new ways. There's a whole restructuring of absurdist strategy taking place right now, because it never works. So what can we do except restructure it? What can absurdity do except restructure absurdity? That's all it can do. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. So there's going to be this massive breakdown of structuring in this world, so that absurdity can restructure its approach, its strategy, and call it new, and think, now we can define God. But of course, it's the more things change, the more they stay the same. That's all it is. The more things change, the more they stay the same. This is absurdity. This is the dance of absurdity. This existence is a dance of absurdity, is all it is. But there will be this breakdown of structure coming. And all our habits that were good habits, that we think are good, they won't work anymore. The men can't be heroes anymore. And the women can't find any heroes to manipulate and... right, and do the feminine thing to soften the hero. Say, yeah, we want these really strong heroes, but we got to soften them up a little bit so God will accept them. In other words, camouflage it, put the lure on. You got this sharp hook, but now you got to put the lure, make all bright colors so the fish will grab the hook. That's what the females do, camouflage. They work with the heroes. Males are trying to be these really strong, adamant heroes, and the females try to soften it up. Okay, so this is the co-strategy here. So there won't be any heroes, old heroes, gone. And the women who worked on softening that up, that doesn't work anymore. They don't know what to do. So especially the older people, it'll be a freak out for them. But it'll be a general collapse of culture and society, which is going to be very severe. Very, very shockingly severe. I don't know exactly how it's going to happen. I'm just merely speculating. I'm merely speculating. And I'm just saying there are certain things that could happen. It could be very much a constellation. There's already a constellation of stuff. But something is going to tip the scales here. And a lot of people are putting all their eggs into one basket of Donald Trump. Okay? Let's just put this out there. Holy Spirit said, don't do that. Boycott politics. Very dangerous thing to do. What if something were to happen to Trump? Okay. What if somebody decided he has to be eliminated? And you know that the New World Order very much wants to eliminate him. Now, is he a stooge of the New World Order? That's possible. Okay, because the New World Order sponsors its own opposition. Keep this in mind. This is one of their basic tricks, which has deceived the world, you know, constantly throughout history, is that the elite, they sponsor the opposition to themselves, so that people think there is an opposition, but they're actually controlling the opposition all along. So they just keep fooling the proletariat all along. They just continually fooling them. So Trump could be simply a stooge of the New World Order. to present a supposed opposition to it, which then they get him out of the way, like they got John F. Kennedy out of the way. Okay, because John F. Kennedy wanted to do things his way, and the New World Order wanted to him. They were using him as a figurehead, and so they got him out of the way. He was going to blow the whistle on a lot of stuff, just like Trump is going, saying he's going to blow the whistle on a lot of stuff. So I don't know the answer to that question. Is Trump legitimately a legitimate voice of freedom, or is he a New World Order stooge? I don't know. Difficult to determine. You know, it's difficult to determine. But in any case, they want him out of the way, to say the least. To say the very least. And we're talking about it, the high, you know, highest chambers of New World Order power structure. He's not controllable. They're afraid he's not controllable, which is the one thing that they're most paranoid about. These draconian reptilian mind New World Order absurdist belief is extremely paranoid, and they try to get free of this paranoia. It's fear of God, that God's an abyss. Because again, they think they've defined God, and then, but they feel this feeling of inner feeling, I want to let go of definition, which then they feel will cast them into an abyss, because they say, well, God, if I let go, I'll be God, and God is defined, and I'm letting go of definition, therefore I'm going to be annihilated in an abyss. So it's paranoia. Absurdity breeds paranoia. And the way that the paranoids try to get rid of paranoia is control. So they're control freaks. Now, Hillary Clinton's a control freak, okay? Complete control freak. Now, some will say that Trump's a control freak, and to some extent you could say that, but it's a little different story there. I feel it's a little different story, because I've been up close with Trump before he was a candidate, back in maybe in 2008 or something, or could have been something like that, at Pebble Beach on the golf course. And I took the read of him, you know, I took the read of him intuitively. And I said, you know, he's okay. He's okay. I'm not bothered by him. I didn't find him to be particularly, you know, fanatical or unbalanced or anything like that. I found him to be shrewd and intense and very smart, and very driven, and all these qualities. I found him to be a very heroic figure, actually. And now he's playing the hero. Like I said, Brian Wilson was playing the hero. Now Donald Trump is playing the hero. And they fall hard. So my advice is, do not place your faith in any hero at this time. One moment. We seem to be getting interruptions right now. One moment. Okay. Let me just leave this video like something you to really think about. Very important. Do not put your faith in heroes. This is a disaster. And if there's so many people feeling that Trump is the only hope there is for them in the world, and if something were to happen to him, if they were able to get him out of the way, put him in the ground, like they did Kennedy, this is going to cause a big problem in the psyche, okay? Meltdown. It's going to cause a meltdown. So put your faith in the call to reduce, to simplify, to reduced intensity, to simplification, which is not a heroic path, okay? Put your faith there. I said, I'll be a candidate for president, okay? If you want to think about, I need some candidate for president, well, I'll be your candidate. That's fine. And the first thing I'll do is say, I resign from the presidency. Okay, if I'm elected, I'll resign from the presidency. Okay, so if you need some political candidate, I said, I'll be your candidate, all right? Just look at it like that. Clarity Ross. I vote for Clarity Ross. He's running a non-campaign as a non-candidate. So I am not saying Trump is a bad person at all. No, I said, I took the read of him. I don't think he's a bad person. I mean, I don't think he's evil. I don't. I think he's kind of cool, actually. I like him. He's someone I could play golf with, you know, and I could jab him, you know. We could have banter, and I think he'd take it well, and I think he'd give it back well, and I think he'd laugh, and I think he'd have good humor, and I think we'd have a blast, really. And I think we would get along very well, no problem. I don't see a problem with him, really. Now, everybody has peccadillos and raggedness. Oh, that's all there, too, of course. It's all there. The whole ball of wax is there. But he has some perspective. Okay, but what I'm saying is, don't put your faith in that, because that can be cut off at an instant. Then what are you going to do? What are you going to do then? You need Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ, okay? You need that sort of thing. And you need the call to simplification, and you need to simplify and lower your expectations. The idea that Trump's going to come in and fix the world is nonsense. This cultural collapse is going to happen no matter what Trump tries to do, okay? It's already written, so to speak. This is going to happen. You need to prepare for this storm that is coming. The storm is coming. I can tell you this for 99.9% certainty. It is coming. And you have to have committed to simplification at that point. Committed to simplification. Profound commitment. This is something more than Trump can provide. Okay. Now, if he's elected and does his thing, maybe that'll be helpful. But don't put all your eggs in that basket. Please, I've been saying this for years. Don't put all your eggs in the political basket. This will be a disaster for you. Yeah, we'll try to pull your fat out of the fire if this is what happens. That's very interesting, because the man on the golf course that I helped had this hat on. He was like a patriot type of guy. You know, outdoorsman, guns, and all this kind of thing. He was that type of guy. And he had a meltdown. He completely lost it. So I'll leave you with this. Okay? Think about this. But I was able to help him. I pulled him out of it. I was able to approach him. So there's a lot of people I understand who want hope. But it's Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Okay? Put your focus on that. Simplify and lower your expectations. Very important. Very, very important. That's it.